thrill me.
This show is part of the Thrill Me Podcast Network. Experience more on Facebook and YouTube.
Welcome to the Revealed Rob Show. I am, of course, your host, Revealed Rob, coming at you with all of the news goodies this week, as well as a review, man, where it is the season. So, easy for me to say. I blame the pilk, all right? That's what I blame. If you follow us on YouTube and, you know, all the other social medias for the Throw Me Podcast Network, you know what I'm talking about. I'll get back to that in a second. But appreciate you all joining in to this show. Got a lot of news coming at you, of course, get your mandatory DC and horror news, as well as plenty of other news coming at you, and gonna kick it off, freaking, what is this, holiday month, season's greetings month, whatever you want to call it, with a review of a Christmas horror movie by the name of Krampus, man. So gonna jump into all of that and talk about all of that with you here in a little bit. As always, appreciate you joining in and listening on to the show. It's always great to have people support the show. And speaking of supporting, man, if you can follow us on the YouTube and Facebook and Instagram and we're not on Twitter, TikTok, all that good stuff, man. We got some fun stuff going on over there on the YouTube. We got some video game stuff. We're going to move Twitch soon. We've got trailer reactions. All of our podcasts can be found there. We're talking Metal Groove, Honor's Podcast, this show, the Mr. Wonderful Show, Improper Guidance, all the other little goodies coming as the year ends, and we got new stuff coming next year, man. So follow us all on there, Throw Me Podcast Network. Appreciate you all doing that. And like I mentioned there a minute ago, did a video with my brother Tombstone Josh that we posted last night on the YouTube called the Pilk Challenge, which if you don't know what that is mixing Pepsi and milk, which, yes, yeah, I hear you all throwing up in your mouth right now. Yeah, I did that last night. It's disgusting. But check out the video because it's hilarious. But that's what it is, I guess. You know, you got to do these things. I don't know. A horrible experience. Honestly, horrible experience. Still feeling the side effects of that one. Other than that, you know, did some hanging out with my brother, watched some football, watched him rock the house as the awesome drummer that he is. You know, just, you know, hung out, man. But appreciate you joining in. We can go ahead and get started with the show. Like I mentioned here, got a review for the film Krampus is where we're going to start off. So I'll go ahead and cue up the trailer, and then I'll be back with the synopsis and ratings and then my thoughts. So here comes that trailer.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. With the kids jingle bells.
Merry Christmas!
Looks like Martha Stewart threw up in here.
This is delicious, honey.
A little dry.
Well, mine's delicious.
Mine's dry.
Do you want to trade?
It's the high. It's Christmas. It's Christmas. It's Christmas. Look at
with those holiday greetings and gifts.
How are we going to survive Christmas with 12 people stuck in a house with no heat and no electricity?
Or food.
There's plenty of leftovers, Howard.
Beer it is.
It's the weirdest thing. There's no cars, no people.
How long can this keep up?
Oh.
heard something on the roof.
What the hell is this?
St. Nicholas is not coming this year. Instead, a much darker ancient spirit.
Those are hooves. Elk
or a goat? What kind of goat walks on its hind legs?
His name is Krampus. He and his helpers did not come to give, but to take.
Everybody, hold on to each other.
He is the shadow of St. Nicholas.
It's Christmas. Nothing bad's gonna happen on Christmas.
Freaking pilk. Anyways, welcome back to the show, man. That was the trailer for Krampus, or they said in the trailer there, Krampus. Pretty decent trailer there. Didn't give away too much. Didn't show the creatures too much. That was pretty good, but they did kind of show them. So avoid the trailer if need be. This movie came out in, what, 2015, I want to say? Yeah, 2015. The movie is rated PG-13 for sequences of horror, violence, language, some drug material, and terror. It is classified as a holiday horror film, running in at 1 hour and 38 minutes, and I watched it on Peacock, but it looks like it is streaming on other platforms as well. So there you go. While the holiday season represents the most magical time of the year, ancient European folklore warns of Krampus, a horned beast who punishes naughty children at Christmas time. The movie is rated on Rotten Tomatoes with a critic score of 66%, and an audience score of 51%. Wow, this movie seems like it's liked by an audience more than that. Okay, whatever. IMDb has it at a 6.2 out of 10. So, what were my thoughts of the film? Right, so this was not the first time I've watched the film Krampus. I did see it when it released back in 2015 in theaters. But it's been a sparingly watch. I want to say maybe I've watched it one more time since then. Not because I didn't enjoy it back then. I did enjoy it back then. It's just, never got around to it. I'm not like as up on watching films during the Christmas holiday time as I am with watching, you know, Halloween stuff during Halloween. But Krampus is always on the list of I want to check it out. And then for some reason I've never ended up watching it. Like the only movie I ever really end up watching during Christmas time is Jim Carrey's Grinch film. And then sometimes Nightmare Before Christmas. But even with that, I don't really get that done either. But nonetheless, I mean, Krampus was always, you know, something I planned on having in the list, and it ended up being this year the first Christmas movie that I ended up watching for the year, and I do plan on watching some more, and probably will be the idea of this show for this month is just, you know, watching Christmas stuff and reviewing it, probably mostly Christmas horror stuff, because there's another Christmas horror movie that I did see before that I want to talk about on the show. There's one coming out on Shudder this weekend that looks like it might be pretty good to review for next week's episode as well. So, nonetheless, let's go ahead and talk Krampus here. I like the idea of it. I don't know the folklore. I haven't read it. I didn't look into it too much. I've heard of the story before the Krampus film came out. And then, you know, of course, saw the Krampus movie, so I get the idea of it. I don't know how faithful it is to the folklore itself, if it's different or not. You know, Hollywood does have the Hollywood creatism rights to do what they want with stories, so here or there, whether they change anything or not, I don't know. But I did really enjoy the movie again the second time around. I like the way it works, man. I like the pacing of the film, honestly. I'm not like a pace snob or anything like that, but I like the way it all works out. You know, the movie starts off, you know, it's the beginning of Christmas time. You see the craziness of, and I'm not going to spoil the movie, obviously, even though it came out, you know, years ago. I'm not going to spoil it. But, you know, just the craziness of Christmas time, and then you got the young kid who, you know, still believes in Santa and all that, but he's getting razzed for it by other family members for believing in Santa, and that causes confliction in his heart about the season. And, you know, spending time with your family, you know, that you don't spend too much time with, you only meet around the holidays. I mean, we can all kind of relate to this, right? Just, you know, oh man, we got to spend time with these family members, and let's try to get this over with as quickly as possible and all that stuff. It's a thing that happens, you know, or it happens for all families. I mean, it's kind of a universal trend in a lot of Christmas movies as well, you know. I mean, you can probably go back to, and I haven't watched Christmas Vacation a lot, but it seemed like Christmas Vacation, you know, the brother or whatever didn't get along well or was different, which I can see the same kind of vibe here in this movie with Christmas Vacation in this one. Not brother, cousin, like Cousin Eddie or something like that. I'm not the best with Christmas movies, to be honest with you. National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, but, you know, I can see that vibe there. But, you know, overall, I liked the feel of the movie. I like how it went from that into, you know, the getting spooky stuff and all that. You know, it is classified as a holiday horror film. I'm not going to say it's not too, you know, insanely violent. There is definitely some violence in the movie, but it's not, like, over-the-top violence. It's nothing like a Saw movie or Hostel or anything like that. But it does have its moments of terror, I would say. You know, thriller aspects, terror. It definitely gets pretty, it's a pretty spooky film, to say the least. It can definitely scare you if you're not used to these kind of films. So when it comes to that question of, is this something you can watch with the family around the holiday season? You know, it all depends on what your family's into, of course. If you're looking for, like, family-friendly films like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and all that stuff, no, absolutely not. But if you're into kind of some sequences of terror and spookiness and kind of being on your edge of your seat and just, you know, kind of tense feeling, all that stuff kind of movie, I mean, why not? You know, you're already on the edge of your seat during the holiday season. You're like, did I get the right gift? Oh, I hope they like this gift. Ah, I gotta get this gift. Oh, we're running out of time. You're already on the edge of your seat, so maybe you don't want to add a movie to it. Then you want to put you even more on the edge of your seat. But at the same time, the movie is really good, so you probably should add it to your watch list. I mean, if you're a horror fan, you've already got it on your watch list. If you're a casual fan, I think give it a watch, give it a try. It's definitely, you know, like I said, it's not the whimsical, magical kind of deal, but it does do a good job of telling a story throughout the film that is, you know, again, universally, I think, understood if you follow the Christmas. I know everybody doesn't celebrate Christmas, so if you understand the Christmas folklore and belief in Saint Nick, Santa Claus, and, you know, keeping your faith throughout the holiday season and hoping for the best and all that stuff, and then things just going crazy and just over the top, because it does get very over the top at points. Maybe that's why we've seen the lower scores here from Rotten Tomatoes. Again, that audience score surprises me. I thought the audience really enjoyed this movie. But neither here nor there, I guess. But, you know, overall, I enjoyed it, and it was nice to watch again. And like I said, I do plan on having it in my rotation year-round for Christmas time, and it being the first movie I watched this time around, awesome. Go ahead and get that in. You know, because Christmas horror movies, there's always, like, that niche to it, because, again, Christmas is, like, very friendly and family-friendly and cheerful and whimsical. So when you see that they're making horror movies associated with the holiday, it's like, oh, that's, you know, interesting in a weird way. You know, to some people, it's interesting in a weird way. To us horror fans, it's like, cool, man, give it to us. We want to see all this stuff. Like we're acting now with these Winnie the Pooh movie that's about to come out. Like, that's freaking insane. I want to see it. But I don't think this movie ever gets to the point of being extremely over the top. There's going to be a movie I'm going to talk about later on in the news that's happening that is just beyond ridiculous and stupid of an idea. But we'll get to that when we get to that. I think the idea of this movie is solid. I think they nail everything they need to nail. Does it get a little insane at some point? Yeah, of course. But I don't think it ever gets too, like, over the top, like, this is fucking ridiculous kind of thing. I think they nail what they needed to nail with the movie and this. Again, I don't know the folklore itself, but the story they tell in the movie is solid, and it's definitely worth the watch, without a doubt. So, man, I say yes, Krampus is a good movie. Heck, I might watch it again. I don't think my brother's seen it, so definitely can watch it with him again, because I got no problem watching the movie again. It was pretty, it's enjoyable. It is enjoyable. Again, it's a hour and 38 minutes. Pretty cool breeze there, man. So there you go. That's my thoughts on Krampus. I think it's a solid film to watch year-round if you're into horror stuff. If you're not into terror and, you know, suspense and all that stuff, maybe it's not for you around this holiday time, but at least give it one try. Again, it's not extremely violent or anything like that. You will have sequences of terror, you know, but it's not insane, you know, body dismemberments or, you know, anything like that. Jump scares, yes, but not extremely gory. It's not a slasher film. You know, so there you go, man. That's my thoughts on Krampus. Hope you enjoyed it. If you've seen Krampus, watch it again, man. It's worth the fun around this time of year. All right, man, that was the review for this week's episode. Now let's go ahead and jump into our news segment of the show, as we're going to talk DC news, man, to kick it off here. Had some big news dropping about release dates for The Flash movie and show, man. So, of course, we're going to kick it off with The Flash movie, which I am still highly anticipating, excited about. It's my favorite superhero, and yes, I'm an Ezra Miller fan. I don't care. Warner Brothers is moving the release date of its DC superhero film, The Flash, up 1 week. It was originally set for June 23rd, 2023, but it will now be hitting around Father's Day weekend on June 16th. And I believe the Indiana Jones film was coming out on the 30th as well. So less competition to move it up a week as well, which makes very smart business-wise. Also, there was a report from Deadline that indicates that the Flash film stands up next to Spider-Man No Way Home in terms of the level of multiversal material, which in the DC movie will revolve, of course, Michael Keaton, Ben Affleck's Batman. We know the Supergirl's in here as well, as many other things are going to be happening in that film. And also, according to sources, the Ezra Miller starring film has tested positively, quote, through the roof with audiences at every early screening that it has had. So suck it, haters. That movie is looking to be fantastic compared to Spider-Man No Way Home. That's a big one right there, because Spider-Man No Way Home is a really good movie. But again, I'm a DC guy. I love DC, and I especially love The Flash. That is my favorite superhero, so I can't wait to see this movie. I'm super excited about it. Told my friends earlier in a group chat, like, I plan on seeing this movie every weekend that it is in theaters. I don't care. I freaking love The Flash. And again, I support Ezra as long as there's a reason to support them, man. There's still a reason, you know. Nothing has been proven that Ezra's done anything all that wrong. You know, he got drunk and acted stupid, which is not good, obviously. But, you know, the stuff that he's accused of, no going nowhere. So I'm glad that Warner Brothers didn't fall into the cancel culture world there. I'm glad they still have Ezra starring in the film. And I can't wait to see the movie, man. I'm super stoked and excited. Again, I plan on seeing it every weekend. I love The Flash. I love DC. So excited for this movie, man. Can't wait for it to get here. Now, on the other Flash front, the TV series over on the CW is entering its 9th and final season, and the premiere date has been set for Wednesday, February the 8th, and it will be at 8 p.m. It's been a highly successful show over there for the CW, seeing that one come to an end. A lot of the CW shows have come to an end recently. I honestly haven't been paying too much attention to them. I've been saying I was going to jump back into the shows because they're all on, I believe, HBO Max now. Got to double-check that to be sure. I don't know if the shows are still on Netflix or if they're all on HBO Max now. But I definitely want to get back into the shows. I lost watching the show at some point in time and just didn't go back to it. But I did enjoy what I saw, The Flash. I enjoyed a good bit of the Arrowverse, if you will. That's what it was called. But seeing the show come to an end, man, it's an end of an era over there. We'll see where things go. No word if Grant's Flash will be anywhere in the Flash movie. We did see them cross over in a crisis event on the Arrowverse. So we'll see how things work out, man. Let's see, moving over to James Gunn, because James Gunn's always got stuff going on. The co-CEO of DC Studios Films released the first shared the first poster of the Blue Beetle film that is coming next year. Looks fantastic. Great poster. And, you know, some people, of course, commented, and he answered some questions. One of the fans' questions was if Blue Beetle would be the first movie under his guidance, or was Black Adam the first movie under his guidance? To answer the question, Gunn noted that Peter and I will help to guide the already filmed projects for the next year, but the new slate won't start until after Aquaman 2 arrives in December of 2023. So there you go. We already knew that these films were already made, and we're wondering about how things are going to shape up and where they're going to go from there. Sounds like the stuff that James Gunn and Peter are working on now will be after Aquaman happens. So that new DCU feel and everything will be coming around there. But that doesn't mean he doesn't have his hands on the projects right now. Another fan said Gunn's next five movies have nothing to do with him, as they were filmed before his hiring. Gunn responded with, quote, "I wish you told me this before I started giving notes," end quote. Love that James Gunn's not afraid to comment on haters' posts there. But, yeah, I am sure he's working on the films and helping lead them in some way or shape or form. I mean, we don't know where the story's going. We'll have to figure out where things are going from here. But, you know, he's still, you know, he's got his hands prints on. Everything's going on over there. Another Twitter user congratulated Gunn on his Blue Beetle post. And Gunn responded by saying, "And I appreciate it. We're excited to be spearheading the great films made before we arrived and working hard to create an extraordinary, wondrous, and unique DCU beyond that," end quote. It's exciting, man. I can't wait to see where the future of the DCU holds. Again, I love DC. Those are my characters. That's my comic book realm. That's my interest, man. And so I can't wait to see those films and see where James Gunn takes everything, man. I think it's in really strong, good hands with James Gunn. All right, now jumping over to our horror, thriller, sci-fi, fun time, craziness world. Sony Pictures is ramping up its pre-production on the sequel to the 2021 successful film Ghostbusters Afterlife. The film's writer and executive producer, Gil Keenan, is set to take over the directing reins as Jason Reitman will be moving to a writer-producer role. He was the previous director, of course, the director for Ghostbusters Afterlife. He's moving over to writer-producer role. The Afterlife ensemble that includes Paul Rudd and Carrie Coon is on board to return. Not much is known basically about the plot at the moment right now or anything else about the sequel, but it does seem that they will be returning to New York and the, of course, iconic firehouse that was made famous in the original Ghostbusters film. The movie is slated for a December 2023 release at the moment. I mean, we're ready for Ghostbusters. I haven't seen Ghostbusters Afterlife since I saw it in theaters, but I did really enjoy the movie and definitely need to go back and watch it for sure. I have it. I have a digital copy. I think I won a digital copy. Yeah. But I did win a digital copy. Yeah. Yeah. But cool. I'm into the Ghostbusters stuff. Why not? Give us another movie. That last one's pretty good. Let's see. If you're a fan, if you have Netflix and you're a fan of the Mike Flanagan, Trevor Macy haunting shows, we got some bad news for you. Sorry. The genre creators are moving from Netflix and are heading over to Amazon Studios as they have signed an exclusive multi-year overall series deal with the studio. That sucks for Netflix, for sure. The Haunting of Hill House, The Haunting of Bly Manor, Midnight Mass, that might be one that I'm forgetting because we're going off the top of my head here. All successful shows for the streamer Netflix. Now, of course, Netflix is probably not too... I mean, I'm sure they didn't want to see it end, but, you know, they still got the next season and final season of Stranger Things to come. More than likely, it'll be another season of Wednesday to happen at some point in time. So they've got stuff cooking over there that's been successful. But losing this is not a good thing, I guess. I'll be moving over to Amazon Studios, so we'll see what happens there, man. I enjoyed what I've seen from the Mike Flanagan and Trevor Macy stuff. You know, there's been some good creations going on there. And, of course, Haunting of Hill House got turned into a house at Halloween Horror Nights, which was a really good house. So I guess we can, I guess we're not getting any more of his stuff at HHN since they have a deal with Netflix, kind of, sort of. I don't know. I have no idea. But that's that. We'll see where, you know, things end up going there. Let's see. Killer Clowns from Outer Space. The video game is still ramping up and getting ready for its release. And we've got some new information, including new characters who are known as the Lackeys. The AI-controlled minions are here to help with all your clown invasion needs. The invaluable AI-controlled assistants to the killer clowns will hunt down humans and grab them to hold them in place, making it easier for the clowns to take them out. They also raise the alarm and deliver freshly cocooned citizens to the spaceship. You can see the Lackeys in a new promotional video, which is out now. The Killer Clowns from Outer Space video game is, of course, based on the 1988 classic film. Players can team up as either clowns or humans, choosing from a variety of character classes to explore an expansive, ever-changing map with creepy surprises around every corner. That game should be fun. We'll see how it turns out. I'll have to give it a try-ski to see if I enjoy it or not, you know. That can old hash the Friday the 13th talk, but we'll see how Killer Clowns goes. I mean, it was a property that came out the year I was born, so I should kind of, like, support it, you know, but we'll see. Let's see, and of course, last bit of spooky talk here. if the Amityville Horror franchise hasn't done it already with Jumping the Shark, with that last, I mean, there's been so many Amityville horror films. There's one most recently where the house was shipped into space. It's true. Look it up. They have now jumped the shark again and again, apparently, as they have announced Amityville Christmas Vacation, a wacky parody of both Amityville movies and romantic Christmas films. Wally wins a trip to Amityville, and his antics lead to a ghost falling in love with him. Can the spirit of Christmas bring them together? End quote. Amityville Christmas is 47 minutes long, and the trailer is out now if you want to check it out. Good Lord, man, what happened with the Amityville horror franchise? Like, it seems like they're like, oh, let's just, rehashed this too many times already. Let's just, you know, do whatever with it now. Just make it wild and crazy and insane as possible. Like, whew, stuff going on over there, man. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. But if you're interested in that, you know, go check out the trailer, and then you can check that out when it happens. All right, man. Jumping from that news to just overall movie and TV news. Warner Brothers TV group boss Channing Dungey, probably, has said the company is having discussions about expanding its Harry Potter television catalog. Now, remember, I talked on last week's episode, I believe it was, about how it's unknown if they're doing anything with the Wizarding World over there. And now here we are again. So they're flip-flopping on stuff over here as far as the Wizarding World goes. This is, of course, following the success of the Harry Potter reunion that happened earlier this year and the Harry Potter Hogwarts Tournament of Heroes game show that also happened earlier earlier this year. Channing said, quote, "There is a tremendous amount of ambition for that, and we are engaged in a number of different conversations." Said that before stating that not much more to discuss at the moment, but the fan base for Harry Potter continues to be as active and passionate as ever. I wish I could tell you that something was imminent on the horizon, but there is a lot of interest and a lot of passion for it, so absolutely. What's great is that you see how the audience is so engaged and so ready. Our unscripted team did a fantastic Return to Hogwarts special last year that resonated so tremendously. Then we did a quiz show with the Tournament of Houses that Helen Mirren hosted. The audience is ready. They want to go. So we're just trying to figure out what the right step is, end quote. So obviously there's no way they're not going to do anything in the Wizarding World. Obviously that's insane to not be there. And I mentioned earlier with Ezra, I have this feeling, hopefully, fingers crossed, that cancel culture is finally going away, because it's been the stupidest thing to exist the last couple of years. So maybe cancel culture is starting to go away to where, you know, we get some more Wizarding World stuff. And again, there's no way that we're not going to get it. Didn't see much backlash recently when Helena Bonham Carter came out in support of J.K. Rowling. So, we'll see where things go with the Wizarding World. I'm here for it. I love the Wizarding World. I've loved it since the first time I was introduced to it back in middle school. So I can't wait to see, you know, what they have up their sleeve. Don't know if there's another Fantastic Beasts film on the horizon or not. I hope there is. I've enjoyed the films. You know, are they on the same par as the Harry Potter films? Of course not. But, you know, I think they're enjoyable in their own right. So hopefully we'll get some more there in the Fantastic Beasts storyline as far as other things such as television shows. Why not, man? Just give me what you can of the Wizarding World and I'll be there to wizard with it, you know. Let's see, moving over, speaking of flip-flopping, the Margot Robbie female-led Pirates of the Caribbean spinoff might not be as dead as it seemed, with Jerry Bruckheimer, who is, of course, the producer of the Pirates franchise, recently telling Collider that it's not entirely the case that it's dead, saying, quote, "I think the script will come forward at a certain point. We developed two different stories for Pirates, and the other one's going forward first. So that's what we're working on to try to get that one made," end quote. So yeah, they are working on two Pirates scripts. I remember this a while ago. There was the Margot Robbie-led one, and then there was another Pirates movie that they were working on. No word whatsoever if the film would feature Johnny Depp or not. It should. If you're going to have a Pirates movie, you should probably have the man who made that franchise as big as it was as part of it. And I think, again, I don't see why we don't have him in there. You'd be stupid not to. So I don't know what the other Pirates film is at the moment. Not much is really known about it. So we'll see. Two Pirates of the Caribbean franchises apparently on the horizon. Hey, they kind of... Yeah, let's see, moving over to Elvis, Baz Luhrmann has touted that his 4-hour Elvis cut is, you know, getting some more anticipation to it. He mentioned this before, and I believe I talked about it before on the show. And he's ignited even more anticipation for it by revealing that a longer version of the music biopic would restore all of Austin Butler's full concert performances as, of course, the King of Rock and Roll, saying, quote, "It's a director's assembly. It's not a cut. There's a whole lot of material that adds up to 4 hours. Austin did his concerts full out. He did all the numbers. Austin just did it, and it was an out-of-body experience to watch him do those full concerts. So one day I will cut those full concerts together." During a separate Q&A, Lerman added, quote, "I thought it would be great for you guys to have the experience only we had, which is to watch Austin do the entire concert. So I can't say exactly when, because I have to go get through this, but I can say one thing, there will be a day when we do that concert version," end quote. Give me it. I want it now. Freaking love that movie. I do love the movie. I bought it over Black Friday, even though it's on HBO Max, I know. And I could have, if as long as I got HBO Max, I can watch it. I still wanted to own it, man, because I feel that strongly about the movie. It's a really good movie. And Austin Butler did a fantastic job. I believe he is nominated for Best Actor, and he should win. Now, of course, the Oscar doesn't always give the Oscars don't always give the award to who should win. Look at last year, Will Smith won when we all know Andrew Garfield should have won. So that's maybe a little bit biased because I love Andrew, but I mean, it's a little biased because I do like Austin's performance in this film. But there's just those undeniable performances, man. So I'd be insanely shocked if he doesn't win, or if I believe he's nominated. I don't know. I haven't really paid attention to it. But, you know, the Oscars are one of those things I watch when it's on. I don't pay attention pregame before it. But yeah, dude, a four-hour version with the full performances from Austin. Yeah, give me that. Why not? That'd be freaking awesome to see. All right, and before we round out the show here, we've got some Star Wars news. A couple quick bits of Star Wars news here. I feel like I haven't talked Star Wars in a while. So, video game news, first off. The journey continues with a post today that experienced the action-packed gameplay for Star Wars Jedi Survivor at the upcoming Video Game Awards, which will be streaming live December 8th. On the GameAwards.com, I guess. Is that the only way to watch it? Let me Google it real quick to see how you can watch the Video Game Awards. Just a little type skis going on here. 2022, not 2021. Let's see. How to watch it. Video Game Awards stream live on Thursday, December 8th, 2022 from the Microsoft Theater. How can you watch the show? The Video Game Awards is available to stream for free access. All major streaming services on Thursday, December 8th, with pre-show starting 7:30. What do you mean all major streaming services? Like, what? What do you mean, dude? You know, all major streaming services? So I can just open any streaming service, like HBO Max and Peacock and all that, and I can just watch the show? Is that what you're telling me right now? That doesn't seem right, but at the same time, cool. I'm into it. All right, open another article here. How to watch the Game Awards. The Game Awards 2022 will be streamed live on all major social media platforms through official event pages. So YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok. Video Game Awards will also be officially broadcast on Steam, IGN, GameSpot, and was that Trovo? So there you go. There's your way to watch it. So YouTube probably, or Twitch would be the way I end up watching that. I'm not going to watch it on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram or TikTok. That just sounds horrible. Anyways, that game, Jedi Survivor. Can't wait to see some more stuff about that. I loved the first Jedi game, Star Wars Jedi. Was it Fallen Order? I loved that game. Had a good time. I need to upgrade that to the PS5. Maybe they'll do a double release with both of the games, like they did with Spider-Man, because you got the Spider-Man game, you got Spider-Man Miles Morales, which I need to get both of those as well. But I'm excited, man. I can't wait to, you know, jump back into that. I always hoped that they would get a game like that, but you can create your own character. But I'm into this, man. Cameron Monaghan is fantastic as Cal Kestis, however you want to say his name. Can't wait, man. Can't wait to jump back into that. Speaking of things I should jump back into that I haven't, this is more of I haven't. The Mandalorian. We've got an update on that. The Mandalorian and Grogu. Most people call Baby Yoda, but it is Grogu. I do know that much. We know that the return is March 1st. Of course, only on Disney Plus. So if you're into The Mandalorian, you've been waiting for that next season of The Mandalorian, Mando, if you will, it is returning March 1st, which means I've got some time to catch up, you know, because I haven't fully, I think I watched 2 episodes, maybe 3, I don't know. And honestly, since it's been this long, I probably got to rewatch it anyway, so Cool, man. Why not? Star Wars news for you right there, on top of all the other movie news, on top of the spooky news, on top of the DC news. The Flash is going to be here earlier. I can't wait. Again, I'm not kidding, man. I will see that movie every weekend in theaters if I get the chance to, for sure. It deserves it. I think it's going to be fantastic. It's already being compared to Spider-Man No Way Home. It's getting fantastic reviews through the roof. I mean, I don't even remember the last time we got this with a DC movie where it's been positive reviews. Was it freaking The Dark Knight? Like, it's been a while since we've been seeing a positive testing reviews for DC. It always seems like people are shatting all over DC. But seeing the positive reviews through the roof, especially with people, you know, feeling the way they feel about Ezra, good to know. Good to know the movie's testing well. So I can't wait to see. God, I'm so excited for that. Getting a week sooner. It was going to be like my birthday movie, you know, like June 23rd. My birthday is June 27th, for those who didn't know. Speaking of, special birthday shout out to a Thrill Me Podcast Network member. I'm not going to tell you the actual date, because why? But it is the lovely Zach from Honor's Podcast. Freaking Improper Guidance. He got some other stuff working over here on the Thrill Me Podcast Network. It's going to be his birthday week, man. So shout it out. Give him the applause. Send a happy birthday out to the universe for the awesome man. He does some great stuff with here for the Thrill Me Podcast Network. Great stuff in general. Pretty awesome dude. So happy birthdays to you there, Zach. And then, you know, I guess we can end the show there. Appreciate you all taking the time to listen to the show. Again, please follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok. I think there's a Twitch out there. Got all kinds of video game stuff going on, kind of, sort of. You know, we'll get there, man. But we've got some gameplay out there. We've got trailer reactions. I just did that stupid Pilk challenge. Oh, my God. I'm still feeling the effects of that. But nonetheless, appreciate you all. Hope you have a great rest of the day, week, month, year, whenever you listen to the show. This year is almost over. Cherry on into next year, man. But as for now, that's the end of this show. So thank you for joining along. And remember, as always, that happiness can be found even in the darkest of times if one remembers to turn on the light. Talk to you all next episode.